And lastly, I'm making that announcement about the next one on 21st, same time. I put a slide like that.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. We'll inform that also.
Yeah, is that all right?
Yeah, perfect, sir. Absolutely.
Ashok?
Yes, sir, perfect.
Okay.
Yeah, his consent is a must, definitely.
No, I already messaged you, sir.
Yeah, I know.
It's an honor to hear to you, sir.
I had to look after two bosses.
And both your students are ready to take up the challenge anytime, sir. Absolutely. So, Ashok, thank you very much for providing this platform. Friends, we are having a webinar series where Dr. Anand Thakur, sir, is going to enlighten us on various principles of mechanics, mechanisms. So, we had a lecture on nailing principles. And we had a lecture on locking plate principles. Now today, we are fortunate that he is talking to us about bone screws, the concerns about bone screws. And without much ado, I would introduce Dr. Anand Thakur, sir. He has written book on locking plate principles and other books as well. So he'll be presenting. All of us know Dr. Anand Thakur, sir, very well. He's ready with his talk and we'll be shortly starting. Let me introduce Dr. Alok Kumre, who is orthopedic surgeon practicing at Nagpur, and he'll be coordinating this webinar. Also, he'll be taking up all the questions. There will be two slides in between where Thakur sir would like us to ask the questions, so that will be displayed. So friends, keep your questions ready, and I invite Thakur sir. Thakur sir, thank you very much for accepting this, and can we have your lecture, please? Thank you.
Am I on?
Yeah, you're on, sir. And first slide is on.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Chandak and Dr. Ashok, for asking me to come back again and again and again. I enjoy as much as you enjoy having me. Today we are going to talk about bone screw, and let me say what is the plan for today. In the first section, I'm going to discuss the final points of the anatomy of the screw. Gross details, everybody knows, but there are certain minor things which make the difference between a safe placement and unsafe placement. We'll talk about those points. Then I'll discuss the established functions of the screw. And lastly, I'm going to introduce you to new functions which have been recently accredited to the screw and are not very well known. So in three sections, we will have this talk. And in between the sections, there are question time, and we should be happy to discuss whatever our problems are. Bone screw is the most frequently used implant in orthopedics. What it does is holds two broken ends together, and when required, it compresses them two ends and also lags them. Lag means it does the same thing with a rather force or a compression. We shall take it up a little later. Grossly, there are four sections of the screw: the head, the shaft, and the tip. And the most important part is also on the shaft, but is overriding is what we call it as threads. Starting with the head. Head functions as a place where we can apply the torque. Applying torque or torsion to the screw head is the essential part of inserting the screw. So we need a good place for that, and the head provides us that place to apply the torque. It also acts as a stop. When it comes to an end, it then pushes the plate towards the bone and creates a compressive force, so that the plate and the bone can stay together. That is the function of the screw. It acts as a stop and then converts this torque or the torsional force into the compressive force. Important portion. It converts the torque or the twisting force into a compressive force. On the head, we are very familiar with this hexagonal socket. What it does, it has got angles of 60 everywhere, and our special screwdriver will use that 60 angles to transmit the torque to the screw head. However, very often it slips, and that's why a newer design has been introduced in orthopedics, which is called Torx. When I'm saying newer design in orthopedics, both the designs are used in industry for a very long time. Besides these, there are at least 20 more designs for a socket in the screw head. And they are used in specialized industries and specialized places. For us, these two are important, and there is a third one coming up. So what happens is when we switch over to torque, we are applying the torsion at the narrower angle at 15 degrees as compared to the 60 degrees. And that's why there are less chances of slippage, and the transmission of the force, transmission of the torsional force is more efficient. All the force that we apply in torque is directly transmitted to the head. So mechanically, this torque head, this is a screw head or straw setting, is more efficient in transmission. So it makes it easier for us to put in the screw. A third one also is quite popular in orthopedics. It's called Phillips head. The Phillips socket is similar, but it has got a cross with the central one. And in the center, there is also a depth. So when the screws are very small, Phillips socket is preferred, and it is very useful. So all these three sockets are common in orthopedics. And whenever we deal with it, we should have screwdrivers for all these three sockets. Particularly when we are going to remove a screw, we should have the Allen keys for all these three sockets, which are available in industry. And very easily, I have been saying it is available in Amazon. So you can purchase from there and keep it handy when it comes to removal of screws. The next portion of a screw is called countersink, which is the rounded bottom section of the screw. It is rounded, so it fits in snugly in the screw hole or also in the screw plate. It could also be triangular in certain situations, but the new thing is the locking screw. In the setup that we use, the Synthes screws, they are all triangular sides and it has got threads. So the countersink could be of the three varieties. The next part is a shaft. One without the threads is also a shaft, and that is the strength of the screw. The thicker the shaft, stronger the screw. But day to day, we are concerned with the threads, which are also imposed on the shaft. These four types are very common, but the buttress thread has been dominating the scene for the last 30, 40 years. It is popularized by Synthes, by AO Systems. And it has been the screw of use for all this time. It offers very strong resistance in one-directional axial loading. If we enlarge the thing and we say in axial loading, it will have a very good hold when we are doing a pull-out, or in the opposite direction, it will have a hold there also. And this was an improvement on what we used to use the V-thread before that. So for a long time, orthopedic fraternity thought this is the ultimate shape that we should be getting used to it. But this has problems. It is weak against multi-axial forces. If we do it on this sideways, then only two or three spots are there. So these drawbacks of the conventional buttress thread are, during insertion, as the screw advances, the bone chips are pushed back. And that's why sometimes it gets jammed. When the screw is inserted, we get the bone chips, we come out towards the insertion side. Some of them get jammed, and you would remember instances when you had to back up the screw, push some saline, clear up the debris, and then the screw would go easily. So this is because they get jammed, because the design is such that they get jammed. It pushes the chips back. In the pilot hole, the bone chips may get trapped between the metal and the thread, and this may lead to jamming. And also, when it jams inadvertently, one may apply higher torque and they strip the bone thread, so the whole exercise becomes a futile stuff. there could also be micro fractures surrounding the pilot hole that will enlarge the hole and loosen the grip of the screw on the bone. So it may fail altogether to get them. To overcome, now a new thread technology has been introduced, which is called interlocking thread technology. It resists bone loads in multiple directions. It distributes also forces from the threads to the bone in different directions. Once you see the outline, you will realize there's a different thing altogether. And when it is in uniaxial, it has got two points where it will interact. These two points are for load distribution and force equalization. In mechanics, they mean a lot. For orthopedic surgeons, it doesn't mean much. But what it really is that there are several points which interact with the bone instead of just one or two that we saw on the buttress thread. In this system, there are several points which will distribute the forces and equalize them very efficiently. And in the opposite direction, again, you have another two points, not one, another two points on each face. If you do it the sideways, then there are several other points which will come and interact. So when the entire screw is loaded in this direction, you can see there are several points which will resist the pull. Same thing happens in the opposite direction. So many points are resisting the pull. So it's multidirectional and multifaceted. Because the threads are slightly curved, it is exposed to more bone. So the distribution is over a wider area. The hold is good. And the stresses or the strains, deforming forces on the threads are also minimized. And the off-axis load, you can see there are so many. If this is the ordinary synthesis screw, only 4 points. When you go to the interlocking screw thread, you will have so many things coming up here. So you can see that off-axis load here is so strong. And on the trailing side also, there are loading points that they are helpful. So many points will resist as compared to the what we saw earlier. So this is a more efficient screw. And it will resist the torsion or the deforming forces more efficiently. Maximizes bone volume, preserves bone architecture. It has got a circumferential interlocking interface and withstands maximal multiaxial forces. So this way, mechanically, this design is far superior to the buttress thread, which we have been using for a very long time. This screw has a special new cutting device. It curls the bone chips away. It pushes them forward and it produces a solid bone implant interface free of debris. It also prevents iatrogenic bone destruction during screw insertion. Let's go back to our original mobilizing. This is what we have been used to it. There could be jamming, there could be micro fractures, and there could be stripping of the thread. In the new design, what happens is the chips come out of the bone in the same direction. So there is no jamming, there is no excessive torque, there is no fracture, and there is an excellent contact between the new threads and the bone threads. It gives a better grip. And all this is possible because the cutting mechanism is specially designed. I can't give you details of that because it is under the patent thing. So they have not disclosed what it is, but it is more efficient. That the screw is available for commercial use in limited centers. And presently it is available for in 3.5 range, but once we start asking for it, we'll get it in India also. In America, it is available for anybody who wants to use. The screw works as a simple machine. One of the simple machines is the slope or a incline. If you imagine a wheelbarrow being pushed on a slope, you'll realize that you have to put in a lot of work. And if the slope is flat, then you have to work less. If it is very steep, you have to work harder. example would be this machine. If we lower or increase the height of the plank, then the amount of load or force required to push the wheelbarrow up would be more if the slant is somewhere. But if you lower it down here, one can do it easily. That means the work required is less in the minor slope and more in this thing. So this thread is an inclined plane, but it is going around in circles along that shaft. As you can see here, it is an inclined slope, but it is going round and round and round. So steeper the slope, more force you will add to, and more potential energy the object will have it. That means closer the threads, stronger the hold in the bone. Farther away the threads, weaker the lesser the effort required, and weaker is the hold. Which screw has a stronger hold? I would say closer the threads, stronger the hold. I repeat, closer the threads, stronger the hold. If the pitch is small, that screw will hold better. If the pitch is large or wider, that screw will hold lesser. In the example, you will immediately follow that the cancellous screw will have the weakest hold, and the interlocking screw, locking screw will have less, because this pitch is even smaller than standard 4.5 screw. So this is the strongest hold, this is the intermediate, and this is the weakest hold. Because it holds far superior in the bone metal. Now, the tips of the screw are of various types, and we know most of them. First one is a self-tapping tip, which it will cut its own threads also as it advances. But this is non-self-tapping. This has no mechanism. As you can see, there is no special mechanism. So it cannot enter the pilot hole on its own. One has to make threads with a separate instrument, and then it can advance. This is a corkscrew tip, which is usually used for cancellous bones, cancellous screws, because in cancellous screw, we do not use any tap for reasons we'll come to talk a little later. This is called trocar tip and mostly used in Shan screws or the skeletal pins, which we use for external fixation. This is the common type of the tip. And this is a self-drilling and self-tapping drill bit. This is a drill point, and beyond that, there is a tapping mechanism. So in one shot, one can drill and tap and insert a screw. Whenever this tip is used, the screws are unicortical, because one cannot afford to have this sharp tip getting out of the far cortex. That will hurt the patient, also damage various soft tissues around. So this one was in between, it was quite popular, but of late, it is being used less and less. Self-drilling, self-tapping tip. So all these five tips are prevalent. Now, before we insert a screw, we have to make a drill hole, what is called as a pilot hole. And for that, we use a specialized instrument called drill bit. And drill bit looks quite attractive to me as a mechanical thing, but the only two things are very useful. The cutting edge is here. The slanting triangular area, that is the cutting edge. And that is the function one that will work. The more impressive is the shallow groove here. And this is not the cutting edge. This is only a channel through which the bone debris will be removed away from the cutting face. So this is important, but this is not the business end. The business end is shown by the red arrow, and the green arrow shows the channel which will remove the material which has been removed, which has been cut by the cutting edge. The principle of this is very simple. There is a wedge is driven over the, this is the bone, and the wedge is driven like this. So whatever comes in front are the bone chips, and these are carried away by that large impressive channel that we see and this is the narrow tip. This principle, cutting principle, is used everywhere, including in osteotomes or a bone saw, or everywhere, same cutting principle. Now, when we drill, before we start drilling, before we start the machine, drill machine, we must start irrigation. It should, before you start, the irrigation must start. Then only the drill machine should cut. Why? Because in the first fraction of the second, the temperature rises to over 47, 48 degrees centigrade. This the rise is sudden, and in the first fraction, 1/10 of a second, it will rise. So unless we have the lubricant, we have the coolant in place, the temperature would rise very high at 47, and that will destroy the bone tissue. But if you have the lubricant or the coolant in place, the temperature will not rise to that deadly level of 47, but would be dead. So one must use, and one must also use the sleeve, some sleeve like this here. And if you don't use the sleeve, the drill will wobble, will loiter around, and your mark of drill point will be, you will miss the target. So also with the sleeve, you can protect the soft tissues around. So for drilling, you must have a sleeve, and you must start the irrigation or the coolant right before you start the drill machine. The video will show you what are the good drilling practices. There's no sound, but I can make some comments. Insert the sleeve first. And again, here I'm emphasizing the saline start before the drill machine started. It should continue, but it should start before. So there is some coolant in place when you do that. And the noise that drill machine makes will tell you whether, when you are gone through the first cortex, near cortex, the sound changes. Far cortex is also drilled. So you have to do it two steps and pay attention to the noise that drill machine makes. And also never forget to start saline before starting the drill machine. After drilling, we have to make threads. And for that, we use an instrument called tap. A close-up of tap is here, which will show you that this long channel is again for removing the debris. It doesn't do the cutting. The cutting edge is here. This is the cutting part. This is the cutting edge. This is the business end. That long channel just removes the debris. And again here, many times you are advised to make a half a turn back, 2 turns forward and half turn backward. That is to cut the bone chips. Otherwise, a long bone chip may again jam it. If you cut, turn it back, the bone chips are cut in smaller pieces and easily carried out. So your tapping is more efficient. This is non-self-tapping screw tip. There is no mechanism to cut it. So we have to make a tap with that instrument that we just saw, and then we can pass that screw. As long as this is self-tapping screw, the mechanism which makes the threads is already cut into the machine, into the screw, is shown by the red arrow, and it's called a self-tapping screw. The enlarged portion, the narrow valley, dark valley, is only to carry the bone chip away. While the cutting business tip is what you just saw. Self-tapping tip. This is the business tip. It will do the cutting part of it. There's some disadvantage of tapping. It removes substantial quality of bone, particularly from the cancellous bone. In context, it doesn't matter. It doesn't remove so much. But in cancellous bone, which is as such thin and weak, as compared to the cortex, we do not advise tapping. When we are inserting cancellous screws, we use tap only for the outer cortex. Once the cortex is tapped, we take away the cancer, we take away the tap and then insert the cancellous screw without further tapping. To emphasize my point, here is a diagram which shows the marked out area is these two points. This is the tapping hole. This hole has been tapped, so the hole has become slightly larger as compared to non-tapped holes, which is number 3 and number 4, their contact is easier. The next diagram will show the same point more. The red part is the tapped area. You can see there is a gap between the thread and the screw. So that means the bone has been removed here. And even with starting point only, the cancel screw is ill-fitting in this tapped screw. But when you are not tapped, the bone is very close and these threads are very well holding it. The cancellous screw will come to that little later, but cancellous screw doesn't require a tapped hole. They make their own threads by compressing the soft cancellous bone to the sideways and then they make their own threads. So the whole thing is closer fit in a cancellous bone if you are not tapped it. Tap is only required for the outer cortex. To reiterate, cancellous bone tap only the thin metaphyseal cortex. Now, this is another instrument which is very useful. It's called countersink. Same terminology as the side of the screw, but this also. When you use just single screws like this, you have to use this kind of instrument. If you don't, there could be trouble. Now, if there is no countersink use, then the screw head will stand out like this, which is a protrusion, which is not a nice thing. And second thing is, if you press too hard, the likelihood that the cortex will crack because of this triangular area pressing against the oval hole, there's a chance of splitting this because the application of force only at limited points. The picture here is showing the screw and the bone contact is only at two spots, not overall, not continuous, not contiguous. It's only at two spots. If the pressure is applied, the force of inserting the screw is applied only at two points, it's possible that the bone may cut, may splinter, may crack up. So we use a countersink. We use this thing, so the effect is that this thing will nicely fit squarely in the hole, which is very good. This is the again in life and a close up of that machine. These are two countersink stuffs. Now, if the cortex is very thin, then there is not enough depth for the countersink to work. So instead, we use a washer. This washer will dissipate the triangular force applied by the screw and will spread it evenly and will not cause any damage. As you can see, the cortex is so thin. If you use that countersink machine, it will not work here. It will cause damage. So in thin cortex, we use this thing. If you don't use this washer, this is what will happen. Because of that narrow area underneath the screw, the cortex will break and we will have a loose fixation. Particularly if you are using a lax screw, whole purpose will be lost. So thin cortex, always use this thing. When we insert a screw in a plate, again, there is a small video, manual insertion. Here, screw. First, I'm using a conventional screw. So, as you know, in locking plate, you can use both the screws. First, it is centered. And first, I'm showing the manual thing. I use this special clip, which is available, which works as a screw holder. And screw is inserted with continuous motion. Don't start and stop, go on continuously moving it. That is the best way to work with it. There's no sound with this video, so. Just tight enough, no, it will not do. Never over tighten it. With practice, you get a hold and you say, but that's enough. We can use it with power also, but it requires some experience also requires some patience. Again, the clip is attached, and then this green one is also self-tapping, so we don't have to do the tap part, and the plate hold is steadied. Keeping the hand steady is very important, otherwise screw can go either way and lost the track, and we have to do the whole thing again. In locking screw, you always use the
Alok, is the sound muted now? I think there is some interruption. It is holding on. Just wait for a moment. Alok, are we getting the sound?
We are getting the sound from your side, but Thakur sir's voice is not coming.
Yeah, so I think it is stopped video.
From his side.
Yeah. Hi.
He is offline, I suppose.
Let him log in back.
Yeah.
Let us hold on for that. Wonderful thing to learn all these things, Ashwin. Hello.
So minute things and very important.
Yeah.
Was studying the concept of countersink.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a nice thing to learn. Thakur sir is joining back. He had a power issue at his home. So he's joining back within a moment. How many times, Alok, you are able to countersink?
Sir, very few, because that particular tap here showed countersink tap. It is not available all the times and I don't have it personally. But it is a good device, I think.
Many times it happens, you want a thing and it is not available. But even if it is available, we do not use it. And therefore, it is not available. So, it keeps on happening. But many times the bone also, cortex is thin, where we are not able to use it, especially with 3.5 or 4.5 screws in humerus and forearm bones, we are not able to use it. I think our Indian texture of bone, osteoporosis also does not allow us to use many a times. Yeah. Let us hope his power comes back fast. Yes. By that time, if there are any questions.
Yes, sir. There was how much the opposite cortex, the screw should be out from the opposite cortex?
Yeah. Would you like to answer that yourself?
Sir,
in your practice, what do you do?
Sir, I keep it around 2 threads from the opposite cortex. I see to it that it should not be more. And definitely it should not be less. So, but what is the practice you follow?
I usually 1 thread is out.
One thread
is out. So if only the screw tip is touching the cortex, then the last thread is not engaged.
Yeah.
So I would usually, and that also depends on the TPI, that is the thread per inch.
Yeah.
So if you are using a 14 TPI, at least 1 thread should be out. If it is 20 TPI, then even if it is touching and just 1 thread is coming out, that's fine. So let's see.
Ashok, keep 1 to 2 threads
out. Yes, that's a good thing. Especially for an interlocking bolt, it is better because they are likely to break more often. That minimum 2 threads are out. Minimum 2 threads are out. Let us get the answers from him. Ashok, are we getting him back?
I think, sir, Dr. Ashok might have.
He might, yeah, I think I'll just call up Thakur sir. I think the laptop power could have gone. Let's get the feedback. We'll get him back immediately. That gives a nice time to rewind our own mind onto all those types of screw head. Most common when we were registrars, we used to have these slotted ones.
Yeah,
and we used to have screws which had a slot inside.
So now also 2mm screws come in slot only.
Yeah.
The small diameter.
Yeah, they also come into that slot. And it has become really a big thing to maintain all the armamentarium of screw. Every set would have a different screwdriver. So what is the way you are managing?
I don't have many screwdrivers, but I took around three to four screwdrivers of different companies, because I don't know sometimes this screw doesn't, the driver, it doesn't work for one particular type.
Yeah, since we use
two or three
different type of screwdrivers. So many Indian screwdrivers or even the imported ones may not fit well into a recess of a screw. So I think it's always a better strategy. But yeah, for the mini fragment set, the hand set, etc.
There is a specific screwdriver for that particular set. I don't like set. To disturb that screwdriver. I don't use that screwdriver for that.
Yeah, so that is contained in the set itself.
Sir, there is a question from Dr. Kimatkar, sir.
Mm-hmm.
What about the locking bolts, the screw threads? And this applies to all tapped and self-tapping screws. The principle which sir had told.
Sir, welcome back. Welcome back, sir.
Sorry. Share the screen.
No, it's all fine. We were just taking up a few questions and we were interpreting. No problem. Take your own time, sir. There was one interesting question. How many threads should be out of the bone?
Sorry?
How many threads should be engaging the bone, or how many threads should be out of the bone on the far cortex?
It depends on the what type of screw you are using. If you are using a self-tapping screw, then this area of the self-tapping area, that's the groove for making the threads, that should be clearly out of the bone.
Bone.
If
yes.
you are using a non-self-tapping, then it can be just flush. But even in that, if you have one thread is out, then you are sure that you have got excellent hold on the bone. Otherwise, one shot means it is poorer hold.
Yeah. So, a parallel question was, in an interlocking bolt, would you use a tap? And how many threads should be out in an interlocking bolt?
The interlocking screw, what do I do?
How many threads should be out of the bone?
Same. All the synthesis interlocking screws are self-tapping. So we have to clear it up beyond that. That is fine.
Okay.
I'll come up with this answer also, because the interlocking screw can use only unique article. So what is the need to go outside? That is not the right way to use. One should always aim for bicortical grasping, whether the screw is unicortical, if it is a cortical screw, standard one, or a locking screw, okay. Always aim for bicortical grips.
Okay. We can proceed with the
One question from Professor Kimatkar, sir, from Nagpur. Should I ask?
Yeah, sure.
Sir, do we power drill the tap screw?
Yes, we do that, but for demonstration, I didn't take it up because it's a bit tricky to use power drill and power and on the tab. So I thought there could be many new people on this webinar. So to show advanced tricks could be disastrous. Once you are used to all these things, most of the time you are using power drill to do tapping as well as inserting the screw. But it requires experience. There is chance of damaging the bone threads. So one has to be careful. Even if you are experienced, you still have to be very, very careful. So it's not for beginners. It is for the seasoned people, I would think.
So another question is there from Professor Kimatkar, sir. Does biofilm form over the screw ends?
In an infected scenario, you are asking.
In case of infection, yes, it will form over any metal that is inside, it will form. Screws cannot be exception to that.
Yes. That's okay. So we can proceed, sir, now. Yeah.
Okay. They say if anything is likely to go wrong, it will. And that is what happened. I had kept my phone on the side table and in the vibrating mode. It vibrated so much that it dropped down and switched off the name. And that's why I went out of phone.
But one good thing is our grasping power has increased because of that break. So we are all happy, no problem.
I'm not feeling so bad. This morning, if you watched the Prime Minister's telecast, even his video got stuck for about 7 seconds on Doordarshan.
Yes.
That's some relief to me.
Please. No problem.
There you go. We see now how the screw works in bone. That would be our next thing. Newton's third law of motion. Again, some kind of physics. Orthopedics is some percentage in physics also. Is that every force has equal and opposite reaction. If we want to grip the, if you want to tighten the screw, then we must have an elastic force, and that elastic force must come from somewhere. The screws are usually classified as wood screw and machine screw, because the way we put insert them is different. That's why they are classified. Now, first we take a machine screw, which we put it in a metal. The metal is very hard. The screw is also made of metal, but it is not as hard as the block in which you are going to put. So in metal, you have to make threads first and then insert the screw. So between a chunk of metal and the screw is weaker. So as one tightens the screw elongates and provides that elasticity required to hold the plate and the metal block together. So the screw elongates and provides the elastic force. In bone, it is a different story. Metal screw is stronger and will not deform easily as compared to wood or bone. Wood and bone works usually similarly. So when the screw is inserted, the wood is compressed and then it provides the elasticity required to hold the screw there. So the quality of wood matters then. Quality of bone also matters. If you see here, this is the cortical bone. You can see how thick it is. It is like a hardened, seasoned wood, like the Burma teak. So it is very thin, very thick. Here we had to use a special device called tap to make the threads in the bone. Then we can insert the screw. And that's like a metal screw. That's like a metal screw. But in wood, we can also just make a drill hole and, here there is you can see this is cancellous, very thin as compared to this. Very, very thin. This is very dense, very thin. So here, if our metal is much stronger than this thing, and once we make the pilot hole and we push the screw with that corkscrew tip, it will just go on compressing the cancellous screw on sideways and forms it. It will compress the bone into thread form. And that's the way it gets the excellent grip. We saw that figure in which I had shown, once you tap it, you get a larger hole. But if you pass the screw just like that, it compresses this cancellous bone around its threads and takes the hold. So, there we are, this starting now. So, how works in cancellous screw? I just said, once you make the pilot hole, you pass the cancellous screw, which is much harder than the cancellous bone. It will compress this cancellous bone around its threads and will shape them into a thread form. And as it stays there, it will also create the compression there. So in bone, whether we use a cortical screw or we use a cancellous screw, the elastic force always comes from the bone. So when we are using conventional screw, the health of the bone is always a matter of concern. It's also a matter of importance. So if the bone is healthy, then screw hold will be tight, irrespective whether it is cancellous or the cortical bone. If the bone is porotic, then the grip will not be so strong as it would have been in a young or a healthy bone. ultimately what boils down to is what happens between the screw threads and the bone interface. And here the force active is shear force. The bone, the small amount of bone which is entrapped between the screw thread, the strength of this middle one which matters. Singularly, one can easily break off, but together, you have so many thread forms on either side, so they make that grip work. But what matters really is the strength of this screw thread, the bone thread, which is engulfed by this screw thread. This is the functional unit. Only thing, we have it several times over. Usually, say, on a 1 inch, there are about, say, 18 or 20. So you have 18, the 36 interfaces. So this collective strength is effective, but when you go down, only one portion that works. And the shear force is one that needs to be counteracted. Now, how a screw works in a locking plate? Here, there is a different ball game altogether. The fixation strength is at the metal and the screw head junction. There is nothing like health going down. Metals are strong all the time. So every time you fix a locking screw properly in the plate, then it will hold very well. The anchorage is here in the metal. It's only to get the screw, the bone threads here, they are only to get the purchase. They are not compressing, they are not pulling. There is no Newton's law working there. It is just like a insert, like the external fixation pin. It doesn't pull the bone to you. So here is only just for a support, and all the strength of fixation comes here. So it is a different way of doing it, but every time you put a locking screw properly, you are assured of stability. Some details about the locking screw countersink. There are triangular and there are multiple threads on it. If one casually looks at it, it so appears that there are more threads on the head and less threads on the shaft. But that is not the issue. The issue is that the fact is that there are two threads running parallel to it. One thread starts here, the other thread starts here. So once it comes here or goes up to here, then he has a company of the other thread going down, which is coming like this. So first thread, then the second thread. And you repeat that, you can 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. That's why when you look at it this way, you find there are more threads, but the distance between the two threads is exactly the same. Here, also the diameter of the locking screw is wider than the conventional screw. This is because it has to work as a fixator screw. It doesn't compress, it doesn't get any strength by elasticity. It just goes there and stays like firmly. That's why it needs to be more thicker, because it has to take more bending loads as compared to the conventional plating. This little device, this special device for when to be used with locking plates or even otherwise. If we leave too many empty holes in the plate, that remains a weak point. There are 4 or 5 weak points, then the plate is likely to break because of the weakness. So to overcome that, this button has been produced on the empty holes that you would like to leave to get working length or get the elasticity. One can insert these holes so that the plate becomes one uniform and less prone to breakage there. So this is just to overcome those weak points in the plate. Not very much been used, but this is available. And once it is available, people will use it when they think like 4 or 5 screw holes to make sure that the plate lasts long time. They can use these screws. If you look at a better picture, you can see the same thing. One feels there are too many threads here, but there are two threads in parallel, which is the same thing. I'm repeating it so that the point becomes clear. The distance between the two blue threads here and two brown threads here is exactly the same. Only thing, there are two running threads here. There's only one single running thread here. So when we insert unicortical screw, the stability of the screw depends on the number of threads that are engaged here. In unicortical, if you get more than three to four screws, then one has adequate strength to hold that. The plate and screw junction is in metal form, so it is going to stay the way you want it to. It will be very stable. It's very strong fixation. But the looseness may come here if the threads engaged are less than four. In the osteoporotic bone, the cortex is thin. So usually one gets one or two threads. So if there is a rotary movement here, then or torsional movement, then there is likelihood of breaking the cortex and the screw becoming loose. This is nominal grip here. That's why in osteoporotic bones, we say that you should have bicortical hold. Here, even in example, I just penetrated that. I have not gone through the entire tapping mechanism outside. This one is also enough. So if the bone health is strong, then you can use unicortical. Otherwise, when it is in doubt, always use bicortical one. However, it has been now conventionally said that always go for the bicortical hold, whether it is locking or non-locking. In a conventional screw, if you get a hold only on one cortex, the grip is 60% weak, 60% of the total. If you get a bicortical grip, the grip is 100%. With unicortical conventional screw, the grip is only 60% of the normal. That means you are at a disadvantage. Same thing in locking screw, you are then dependent on the thickness of the cortex, over which you have no control. So as a safe surgeon, you would always employ bicortical locking screws. Unless there is an obstruction like a stem or a nail, then that's a different story. But when there is no obstruction, opt for bicortical hold, whether you are using a locking screw or a conventional screw. Go for bicortical screws in all the cases. We'll just compare this to conventional locking screw. The locking screw is axially and angularly very stable. It is MIPO friendly. It does not pull out during insertion and requires only one-third the torque for insertion. Easier to push in this one than cut. However, because the threads are closer, you have to work a little harder. I always find more strenuous to insert a locking screw as compared to a conventional screw because there are more number of threads there. They are closer, the pitch is smaller, and that's why you get to work them. But it's supposed to be easier to insert. Locking screws are larger in diameter. They have to withstand more bending force as compared to the conventional screw. Conventional screw also has the advantage of having an elastic force between the bone and the plate because of the third law of Newton. In locking screw, there is no such advantage, so it has to be stronger. That's why it is wider in diameter. It has also got to higher shear strength. So the deeper threads, they are much useful. Both factors makes it more useful near the joint. Because it is stronger and it can withstand more shear force, you can safely put it near a joint. While in conventional one, you will be afraid because the bones are weak, etc., etc. So it is safer to use a locking screw near a joint area or a broken area. Conventional screw compresses the bone thread to generate load of several kilopounds to get a secure hold. Here, there is no compression generation, not more than a few kilograms of load holding power from locking plate of the hold that we have seen many times. Here, we depend only on the screw bone health to get that the thing. Dependent on bone health, this is dependent on the bone health. Just comparison for me. When you see a closer look at this, which tells us that in a healthy bone, we get hold of 3 to 4 threads on both the cord, one and the other cortex, maybe more than 4 on either side. So you got 8 holes here. But in a porotic bone, if the cortex is thin, porotic bone is thin, it's wider in diameter and cortex is thin. So you hardly get 2 on either side. So the in a conventional screw, in an osteoporotic bone, will always have a weaker group. Over and above, if you do only one cortex, unicortical here, you're likely to fail. Again, here, again, if you do one cortical, you may get away because you already have got 4 here. But your strength will be just about 60%. So again, I repeat, always go for bicortical cortices. Only in rare conditions or where you cannot, then unicortical grip is all right. Here is another question answer time. If you have nothing, then I can go ahead. Is there any questions now?
Alok, you must be having a lot of questions. Alok, can you unmute yourself? Unmute yourself.
Sir, am I audible?
Yes, yes, very much. Are.
Sir, there are a lot of questions, sir.
Yeah.
First is why there is the difference in TPI of head and shaft of rocking bolt.
Sorry, I repeat, please.
Yes, I am repeating. Why is there a difference in TPI of head and shaft of locking bolt?
Threads per inch.
Oh, head and shaft. Yeah, sure. See, the threads on the head are expected to get locked in the similar thread in the plate. Now, plate thickness is only 2 millimeters or 2.5 millimeters. So there is only limited number of threads in the plate hole. Now, if one thread slips, the screw locking is indifferent, it is loose. So as an insurance for non-slippage, the engineers have put double threads on the screw head in a locking screw in synthes screws. This is not so in all other systems. There are 5 systems of interlocking screws. I have not gone there today because it's fairly well known, or it was a lot of diversion. So the double threads are to make sure that the locking screw does not slip in a locking plate. If one thread is slipped, it will be loose. So if one thread misses, the other thread will catch. That's why there are double safe method there. That is the only reason.
Next question, Ali.
Yes, sir. Next question. So can you please elaborate the sequence of using drill, countersink, and tap?
Drill and tap, yes. First, when you want to insert a screw, first thing is to take a sleeve suitable for your drill bit. Then place the sleeve at the point where you want to insert. Then thirdly, take the drill and put it through the sleeve and then stabilize it here and run the drill machine slowly. This way you will make a little dent in the bone that will stabilize your drill bit. And then you can increase the speed. While you are doing this, the sleeve should be very steady and the drill machine should also be very steady. With the pressing of the trigger, you can increase the speed as much as you want. Also, before starting the drill machine, you should start the saline irrigation. You must ask the nurse or your assistant to start saline irrigation before you pull the drill machine. Then you start it. Having done that, withdraw the drill bit. While withdrawing the drill bit, do not reverse the gears. Simply keep it running forward and then pull the drill bit outside. Remove the sleeve, then take a syringe and flush the drill hole. The pilot hole that you have just made, you should flush it every time before tapping or inserting a stamping tool. This is because some debris are left inside and they may cause trouble. So once you have flushed the hole, then take the tap. For tap, there is a different sleeve available. You put the sleeve on the entry point or the pilot hole and then run the tap either by hand or through the drill machine. Again, using a drill machine is a bit tricky, and you should have considerable experience before you start the machine. Best is to start with the hand, make two turns forward, then half a turn backward, then make two turns forward, half a turn backward. This is not possible with the drill machine, but the power is so much that the all things are taken care of. But when you are doing with hand, make it two turns forward, half turn backward. That way you end the you reach the other end, and then back it up entirely and take it out. When you are using a tap on the machine, you have to reverse the gears. In drill bit, you do not have to reverse the gear. In fact, you should not reverse the gear. But when you are using a tap, to take the tap out of that hand, you have to reverse the gear either by hand or by reversing the buttons. So you take that out. Then again, you flush the hole. Then take the screw and then insert that. Insert it in one continuous manner. So that way, easier to do with machine. But when you are doing with hand, also don't stop. Just go on doing it as fast as possible. That way, the insertion is superior.
Sir, next question.
Yeah, yeah. Go ahead with next question.
Sequence of lag screw insertion.
No, I didn't get it.
Sequence of lag screw insertion.
Oh, yeah, that's coming. There's a whole 30-slide sequence on lag screw. And
okay. So we'll wait for that. We'll wait for
this. This was about the anatomy. Now we'll go to the function of the screw.
Questions?
Is there more questions?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Alok, take them right now. Because
a lot of questions are there.
Yeah.
Lag screw questions we can take later.
Yeah, yes, sir. The other questions are there.
Sure.
3.5 cortical screws are available in 14 and 20 TPI. Where and when those are to be used?
They are available in 14 and 20 TPI.
Yeah. Yes, 3.5 screws.
Yeah, 3.5.
Cortical screws. Cortical. They are available in 14 TPI per threads per inch and 20.
I don't think there is any special reason to change TPI on screws. It may be because of the different manufacturers.
Yes.
Or if you stick to one manufacturer, then the TPIs don't change. I am using Synthes since 1981 or so. So I don't get into these problems at all. I know the screws except Synthes. So I can't say that. There is no need for variation of TPIs in the sizes. If you are using 4.5, the same TPI, and this is the same TPI.
Yes, sir. So, next question.
Yes.
In metaphyseal region, the long screw walks in the bone and gets locked in the plate. Does it serve the purpose?
In metaphyseal region, locking screws get locked in the plate.
Plate.
Yes.
It walks into the bone.
But it walks into the bone. So there is hardly any purchase, but there is a locking onto the plate. So does it serve the purpose or it is just lying there?
No. It serves the purpose. It gives you the hold. It's like a Schan screw we apply in cortex. We sometimes apply in the metaphyseal area also. So it gives you a purchase there. And through its combined strength with the plate through the other screws, it gives you a support there. Why, if you see in the lower end of the radius, the T-plate, we put four screws or three screws. They don't have to have any purchase, but they will just stay there in that cancellous area and support it like a tent. As they are spread out three ways, they support the lower end of the radius as if there are tent poles, they are just supporting like this. So they do support like this. So there is a great advantage once their base is stable. They can work like tent poles and support that bone. So no need to have actual purchase because there is no purpose of having any purchase. It is not drawing any strength from the bone. Like the standard cancellous 4.5 or 6.5 screw.
Right.
When you put for the upper end of TBI, you are actually pulling it. Right. In locking plate, you are not pulling it. You are just simply supporting it. And that's why it is more successful in lower end of the radius. We had these T-plates even when we didn't have the locking plates, and those T-plates wouldn't do any great magic. But moment the locking screws have come, the lower end of the radius treatment has entirely changed.
Yes.
Because they are just like a support screws there.
Alok, we take only one more question here and then we go to lecture.
Another 5 to 7 questions more.
Yeah, that we'll take up at the end. One question we take right now.
Okay, sir. Then this is an interesting question from a postgraduate student. Sir, the question is how to identify system of screw to tell as asked in an examine instrument vivas.
No.
How to identify the system of screws?
Yes.
Has to be answered to the examiner in the viva.
How to identify system of screws? Whether it is from AO system or Zimmer system or something like that?
No, sir.
So ask the person who has asked to be more specific in that question. We'll take up that question later.
Difference between an interlocking bolt and a screw.
Interlocking bolt and interlocking screw.
Yeah.
I don't think there is any terminology like interlocking bolt.
Okay.
Actually, one of my last slide was what is the difference between a screw and a bolt. But I removed that for 2 days because it was getting longer and longer. See, the bolt is almost like a screw, but at the other end, at the tip, we put another nut on the other side. So if you put it in a shaft, like regular screw, one would pass it and protrude at the tip further up, and on that tip, we will put down a nut. And that will compress from both sides. So that is called a bolt. Now, locking bolt means once you lock on one side in the metal and then you put a bolt on the other side, I don't see a situation where I will need this kind of an arrangement. So yeah. That either is a trick question for me.
But routinely, whenever we do an interlock femur nailing, the 4 screws, we call them as bolts. So,
yes. Yeah. Because they are thick, that's why one tends to call it as a bolt.
But
unless you are passing a nut from the medial side, then it becomes technically a bolt. And some people do say you pass a bolt nut from their side to give it more stability. But to overcome that, now there is a locking angle stable locking screw with a sleeve, which I mentioned in the last webinar. There is a screw for distal locking, which has got 3 diameters, and an artificial material sleeve is put on it. And as it is inserted, the sleeve expands and locks in the hole of the nail and gives an angle stability, so it doesn't wobble from side to side.
Ideally speaking, all the interlocking screws we are using in a femoral nail or a tibial nail, we should be calling them interlocking screws.
Yeah, technically they are interlocking screws,
but most of us call them as bolts
because they are thick. That's why you want to feel more forceful. That's why I put in a bolt.
Okay.
The screw. But bolt technically has to have a nut on the opposite side, and then it compresses from both sides, then it becomes a bolt. But okay. The terms are interchangeable and change is the first thing that the orthopedic surgeon has done. So terminology change is no big deal. But what we have been using for interlocking are mainly screws.
Yes.
They are stronger screws, partially threaded or double threaded or something like this. What is a good thread? That should have thread at the far end, then there should be an area of without any thread, and then there should be proximal thread.
Yes,
that is the best screw.
Yes. Look, that is the beauty of this lecture. Sir makes the concepts very clear. We all call them as bolts, but however, they are screws. So on this question, I think we go ahead with the lecture of sir first. Let him finish. Yeah, you want to clarify something?
One last question wanted to ask.
Okay. Okay.
Should we use one drill bit per surgery or can we use them repeatedly and how many times?
What do you want to change per surgery?
Drill bits.
Drill bit. If you can afford, yes, brand new drill for every surgery, that is the ideal. But even in oil rich Saudi Arabia and Oman, they didn't throw away the drill bits. The good drill bits are expensive and they need to be used for a few times, but the moment you get the feel that they are dull, you should change them. Changing it for every surgery, I think, unless your patients are like Bill Gates and Warren Buffett, I would reuse them.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thanks for answering that question. And I think after this brief question and answer session, we go ahead to further part of lecture and then we take the rest of the questions at a later time.
Yes, yeah, there is a slot for questions again.
Yeah.
So, what are the functions? Why are we going to use this screw? Like they are enumerated as a fastener, as a placement screw, as a lag screw, as a buttress screw. And the new functions have been ascribed to them as a simple beam screw and a strain reduction screw. I've given the year in which they have been mentioned. So these are new, and you will not find it in many sources. So that would be at the very end, and that would keep you, some of you at least, awake. So fastener is the commonest thing. What it does is fastens the two ends of a broken bone together through the help of a plate, or it can do independently also. As you can see here, this fragment is being independently held by these two screws, while here the screws are fastening these two big ends together. So it works as a fastener. Then here again, I used it independently just for this room. This is just for demonstration. This is not a recommended practice. Just using three screws is not recommended. I had done this in very special condition. And when I operated, this girl was only 14 and the family didn't want a second operation. So I was restrained from using a plate because I said, if I put a plate in 18 months, I'm going to take it out. And they said, no, sir, we don't want another one. So I used these screws, but I kept her in plaster cast for a good 5 weeks and then we mobilized her. But that was at the family's request and my consideration. Because she was just 14. I didn't want to lumber her with a big plate, which will remain for a long time. So this is not a regular way to do it, but it can be done. Placement screw is something like this. All these are placement screws. They are just holding the plate and the bone together. They are not compressing nothing. So they are called placement screws. And the normal use without lagging is called a placement screw. Now, this is a special situation here. The screws have been used as placement screws. What has happened here is through a metal plate, these screws have been passed, cancer screw, in a, say, metaphyseal area or epiphyseal area. The strength of the hold of the screw, or the strength of the screw, is proportionate to the length it goes inside. Actually, it can be represented by this triangle that it makes. From its base to the height, if you draw a line here, this right angle triangle is the strength of its hold, which you can see in the plane. So if we use a longer screw, then this triangle will be a bigger area. That means the longer screw will have a larger hold. Again, I repeat, the hold of a screw in this area, the provision that it must pass through a metal. So here is a metal T-plate and I pass the screw here of this length. The hold can be represented by this triangle. I pass a longer screw. The triangle is of larger area. That means the screw has a better hold. So when you pass a cancellous screw in a metaphyseal area, epiphyseal area, try to pass as long and at an angle so that you can make a bigger triangle inside. That means you will get a better purchase in the screw. The same principle works for locking screw as well. You recall in shoulder, the proximal humeral plate has got locking screws and they go at an angle. So in that angle, it makes a bigger triangle, and the recommendation is go as close as possible. So longer you go, bigger triangle you will make, the stronger will be your hold. And since this is an angle stable thing, you can see that it is supporting like a balloon or two sticks. Now, this is the measure of its strength. Always use a longer screw as much as possible to get a better hold. So I suggest that you pick up a lag screw. In exam, this is a common question. And even if you move your hand by 1 inch, you're going to get into trouble because there is nothing like a lag screw. Lag screw is a technique of insertion and not a screw by itself. It is the most effective way to achieve compression between the two bone fragments. And how do we achieve it? How do we increase the efficiency? It depends on the location of the screw and also the insertion technique. What do we mean by location of the screw? Now, in this situation, you want to pass a lag screw. So what will happen is that lag screw, would you pass it here? Or would you pass it here? Or would you pass it here? Which one is more effective? Which one will give you the strongest possible hold as a lag screw? Well, there is a sequence, we shall do that. The distance between the distal fracture line and the tip of the screw is the measure of the strength of the hold. It is represented by this square or a rectangle. And larger this area, more is the hold. So point of reference is the distal fracture line and tip of the screw. So shorter the distance, weaker the grip. Farther the distance, stronger the grip. So let us see how it goes. Here we are. We are present, is fairly close here, and the grip is less, and it's not a good area. But if we move the tip further away, we get a larger area like this. So this is a stronger grip. This is a bigger square or bigger area than as compared to this. So this is a better hold. But the catch is in the proximal cortex. If you go too close to the proximal fracture line, it is possible that during the insertion, you may tip off this area. So practically, one would not like to go that close to the proximal fracture line for the fear of this breakage. So there has to be some compromise. That compromise is here. So you neither go here or not at the far end, you go halfway between, which is usually the center of the fracture line, and then you pass the, you position your screw here, you get the optimum holding strength. It will withstand the maximum amount of bending load as compared to the ones which we saw earlier. This will take the minimum of bending load because the grip is so small. The effective area is also very small. It will break easily. This one will hold very well, but there's a chance that the proximal cortex will break and you will lose everything. So this is the best position for positioning the interfragmentary screw. This is just for comparison. You can keep remember this picture whenever it comes to inserting or locating a screw, go for the middle path. Now, when we pass the lag screw, we do not want to thread the proximal and distal areas on cortices. If we do that, the screw will have grip on the proximal cortex and also on the distal cortex. And howsoever you tighten it up, it will not compress the fracture. It will then work as a positional screw. those positional screws I showed you, they are only in one cortex. They are not crossing any fracture line. So they cannot compress one single intact cortex. That's why they were called the positional screw. Here, if you thread this proximal and distal cortex, your lag screw will not compress it, but it will work as a positional screw and will keep this fracture line apart. So what you have to do is to drill only the proximal cortex first. You have to have no hold on this, for which we had to have a larger hole in the proximal cortex. Now there are two ways one can do this. One can do a first hole by 3.2 through and through, and then use a 4.5 to enlarge the proximal cortex. This is one method. So if you follow that, you make a drill hole through and through, and then use a larger drill bit to make the proximal hole like this. It is possible that your hole, the drill may tilt, and you may make it a little angle the proximal cortex. So you may make it a little oblique one. So when you pass, or the other method is that you make a 4.5 gliding hole first, and then make a 3.2 drill bit pass through it. So because there is a lot of play, the drill bit may go straight or it may go at oblique place. So what will happen is ultimately when you pass the screw, it may not go the way you want, but it will go sideways. So to overcome that, what you have to do is first do a 4.5 millimeter gliding hole, then take a 3.2 drill sleeve. It's not drill bit, it is drill sleeve of 3.2. And you insert that sleeve here. And then after that, you insert the 3.2 drill bit. This way you have made sure that you will go in the center of the 4.5 gliding hole. So first make a 4.5 gliding hole by 4.5 drill bit, then insert a 3.2 millimeter drill sleeve, inside sleeve, and then pass the drill bit. That way you will make the best. So you will enter the center point of that hole. You will get the target every time you do this. This is an important step that you must use 3.2 millimeter drill sleeve. Most of us take shortcuts by using either a 3.2 drill millimeter drill bit directly and saying that yes, I'm going in the center, and invariably it goes obliquely. Only when then you will get a good compression. If you do it that way, the way I just want to, if you have done it with the sleeve on, then you will get a nice compression and it will sit there. If it is freehand without the sleeve, then you will have problem. And see, there is a mismatch. You lost the reduction because your screw went a little obliquely and it slid away the hole. For want of a sleeve, the reduction was lost. You didn't use the sleeve, which is an essential step. Must be used every time you use a lag hole. You must have an inside sleeve and then drill through that sleeve. Then only you will get it. This is a very fine point, which is well known, and most of the time people use it. But somehow it missed my attention. It had not one time, two times, but four times. In the fourth edition also, I had not been able to include this thing, but I didn't emphasize this any time. Because only now, very recently, after this was published, I was told by none other than this gentleman, whom we all know very well, he brought it to my notice that I have missed this point. So now I'm going to include it in the fifth one whenever it comes. Thank you, Dr. Tanna, for bringing out this very fine but very important point that I missed in last four editions. So once you establish a clear gliding hole in near cortex and use the inside sleeve I made a perfectly centered distal screw, which is then threaded in the far cortex. As you tighten the screw, the compression will be created between the proximal cortex and neocortex, and the fracture line will be compressed, and you will achieve the lax screw effect. Very often we use threaded screws because we already made a larger guiding hole here. But the flip side is sometimes these threads get engaged in the bone because it's slightly tilted or it is not perfectly centered or just it happens. So then the transmission of forces is hampered because some force is taken away by the proximal cortex and doesn't get compressed. To avoid that, one should use a different type of screw, which is called a shaft screw. You see, shaft screw has no threads on the proximal front. Only distal portion has got threads, which will have grip on the distal cortex, far cortex, and will compress the fracture line. These are called shaft screws, and if possible, you should have them in stock in different lengths and use them for the best possible advantage. This is a plastic piece being blown, and you can see the compressive force that shaft screw is generating, which is optimum and even on both sides. So if you use a shaft screw, you will produce more efficient compression by a lax screw technique. Same thing is in this different model. You can see that this is being seen here. Clinically, we apply when we find a big chip, we always lag that and establish the fraction. Again, in small bones also, you can lag the screws. In fact, every time the screw crosses the fracture line, you must lag it. Here, I used it as a lag screw, and because the cortex is thin, I cannot produce even hole there. I cannot, so I used a plate. So any amount of pressure that I have is not going to crack open my proximal cortex. But the washer I have used here is with a different purpose. As you would recall, when there is a vertical fracture, just fixing it horizontally in the metaphyseal area doesn't help, but you should also have a screw in the cortical area. I could have put a 2 or 3 hole plate here, but instead, at the very tip, I have chosen to use a washer and a single screw. So this screw is now functioning as what is called as a buttress screw. Instead of using a 3 hole plate, which is fixed here, and then buttressing this vertical fragment, I use just single washer and use the screw as a buttress screw. This is a important use of this screw, not many, many times done, but when situation arises, you can use the screw as a buttress screw. Lag screw can be put through a plate and then produce a compression across the fracture line, and this is the strongest compression you can produce. Clinical example is here, the screw has been lagged through a plate, and you can hardly see any callus here, and the fracture has healed equivalently. Lag screw through the plate is the strongest for absolute stability. Again, we can put it outside the plate also, as done here, and this butterfly fragment is lagged through these screws. Second way of putting it, the locking plate here, and the screw is being used outside the plate, as you can see in this cross section. Both ways are possible, both ways work very well. Here is a clinical example of screw lagging the bone outside the plate. Instead of using a bigger 3.5 screw, one should use 2.7 screws, because then you are applying compression at two different spots. And this is a more efficient way because of two spots. And also you are thinner screws, which work more efficiently. This I already discussed with you. I use washer in every situation so that I didn't want to break the cortex, but still apply as a leg screw in all these three instances. When the cortex is thin, you should use a washer so that the spread of the force is even everywhere and the bone does not break. So what are the dictums must when we use a leg screw arrangement? Whenever a screw crosses the fracture line, it must be inserted as a leg screw. If you don't do, it will keep both the screw fracture ends separately and they may cause non-union at that spot. A leg screw must glide freely through the near fragment and engage only in the far fragment. That is the only way it will be able to pull the distal fragment towards the proximal fragment and will produce compression and the lag effect. Thirdly, two small diameter lag screws produce more stable and efficient fixation than one large diameter lag screw. Also, chances of breaking the cortex are fewer with two smaller diameters than one larger one. And lastly, for absolute stability, insert a lag screw through a plate. And you do this arrangement, there's nothing better than you can do for producing absolute stability. Now, before we conclude, I just want to talk, because in last seminar, somebody asked me whether we can use a locking screw or a scaphoid fracture. During my talk, I already explained that both these looks like multiple threads. The pitch of this screw and this screw is same. So when this is inserted, it is not going to draw the two fragments together. While this is a Herbert screw, the pitch of this end is different than pitch of this end. So when Herbert screw is inserted in a scaphoid fracture, as it advances, because of the thread differentiation, this thread will pull the distal fragment towards the fracture line, while this one, which is a coarser thread, will lag behind and will be moving slowly. This will move at a slower pace. This will move at a faster pace. So the distal fragment will be pulled towards the proximal fragment because this will then act as a moving head and will produce the compression in this fracture. So the answer is that you cannot use locking screw as a Herbert screw in scaphoid fracture because these threads have identical pitch while these two threads have differential pitch. In fact, these screws come in different varieties now and they are all called as differential thread screws. And they only can produce this thing. So never think of using a locking screw for this. You have to go for the specialized screw. With that, I think another question answer for about your lag screw and the other things.
Hello, I suppose there must be a lot of questions. So question we take... Yeah.
The first question, sir, please explain the flute arrangement in drill bits. Some come with two flutes and some come with three. Which is the better one and what is the purpose? And what should be used?
Yeah, two flute and three flute. See, three flute tips are steadier. They will not wobble everywhere. Wherever you place, they will work at that place. Well, the ones with the two flute, they tend to move about more. So one would... But the one with three flutes are more expensive, so and not easily available. That's why one can do this. Of course, the advantage of three flutes is that they remain steady and also they remove the material more efficiently because there are three channels, so they are more efficient, they will work faster. But two ones will do it slower, but the cost and availability is the issue.
Next question, Alok. More efficient,
you can afford to use three.
Yes, sir. So next question. If we are in a situation to lag a smaller fragment from a larger fragment.
Sorry?
How should we go ahead?
if you are required to lag a smaller fragment to a larger fragment, what should be the sequence?
It's easier to pull a smaller fragment towards a larger fragment. It's difficult to pull a larger fragment to a smaller fragment. So best is to go from a larger fragment to the smaller fragment, pull it towards you. That will be efficient. Physical thing. So from larger to smaller one.
But clinical application for us, say, avulsion of a greater tuberosity shell, we have to go from a smaller to larger one.
Yeah, but there are typical or typical situations, but as a general principle, what would you do if you have a choice? Larger to smaller. Smaller one, you have to be careful, you have to reposition it, and you can do it. Of course, when the final tightening comes, you have to be delicate and not really the usual orthopedic solution. You have to be like plastic guys, be gentle. Yeah. That would be easier.
We can take up a look. Next question.
Next question. How do we classify kickstand screw function-wise?
Which screw?
Kickstand screw. The screw which we put in a buttress plate in tibia from the metafascial region going up to the subchondral region. That is known as a kickstand screw. The one screw which goes obliquely up.
Kickstand screw.
Yeah.
Kickstand screw. Like yeah. The cycle kickstand. Okay. Yeah. Okay. See, that is the new trend. And that screw is not supposed to, that is only to work like a pillar, like a beam supporting the distal end. It is not supposed to be a compressive effect. It is just a placement screw to work like a column or a beam. The one which I'm, the last but one is all about the kickstand screw. Only okay. Thing, they're not calling it kickstand. Kickstand has become very fashionable on the internet these days, but it is just a placement screw working as a beam, as an additional support. And I think it has been newly found, so it is more popular, more being talked about. It's efficient, there is no question about that. And if it is gone through a lock plate, it will be more efficient, like we routinely use in fixing a high tibial osteotomy with Tomofix. There is a screw which goes obliquely and works like a kickstand screw only. So that's only a support screw. Which is another mechanically sound thing. Situations where you use, there is a lot of scope for innovation and invention. Yeah, because you can find many, many places.
Yeah, more question, Alok?
Yes, sir, a lot many questions.
Yeah, go ahead.
Please elaborate on what is the working length of the screw and its significance in osteoporosis.
Working length of a screw, it will come in locking plates when we want these things. When they invented the far cortex locking, then there was discussion of working length of the screw, because the without the diagram, it's a bit difficult to answer, but I'll say. When you're using a locking plate, the screw head is engaged in the plate. Then it has got the next support is in the proximal cortex. And the next support is in the distal cortex. The new screw, the far cortex locking screw invented by Botlang, has got hold in the plate, but it has no hold in the proximal cortex because the shaft is narrow. And then it has hold in the distal cortex. So when there is loading, the screw flexes from the plate base where it is locked and the distal cortex. So the length between the distal cortex and the base of the screw, the shaft without any threads, is the working length of the screw. Now, same thing in a locking synthesis screw. The only flexible part is between the locked plate and the proximal cortex. So in the synthesis system, the working length is very short. It is just that offset of 2 millimeters between the locking plate and the proximal cortex. That is a narrow working length. That's why we do not get any flexibility from the locking screw of the synthesis type. But Zimmer Botlang screw, which is the far cortex locking screw, which is also commercially known as motion lock screw. We have a flexible length, extends from the locked area of the head in the plate to the proximal part of the threaded part, which is locked into the distal end. That span is the working length of the
Zimmer
lock screw. No other screw. In conventional screws, there is no, no necessity to imagine working length of a screw, because if screw gets loose, it just comes loose. It becomes GFR.
Alok, now next question should be a simple question.
No, I had anticipated, I would have shown the picture, things would be easier.
No, we could get it, sir. We could get it. You explained very beautifully.
Dr. Chandak knew it even beforehand. I could get it. But for doctors, it is difficult to explain and understand without the drawings,
diagrams, yeah.
Because we are so used to seeing things and then understanding.
But the minds are so absorbed in your talk that we are getting what you are telling. We are all getting the answers. Absolutely fine, sir. Go ahead, Alok. Alok, go ahead.
So in a few of your slides, you have shown that the tap removes more bone than the screw size.
Yes.
So if it's like that, then what? Why is it designed like that? Isn't the tap supposed to cut exact threads as screw?
Yes. I also said that the more bone is removed from cancellous area, because cancellous bone is less strong than the cortical. So when we use tap in the cancellous area, we remove a lot of bone, and that produces that gap, and that produces a loose screw. And that's why I said that when you are pushing a cancellous screw in a metaphyseal area, tap only the outer cortex. Once you have done the cortex, withdraw the tap and insert the screw, then you don't need the tap, because as the cancellous screw goes through the pilot hole, it is going to compress the cancellous bone and shape it, mold it to its thread size. And when the final molding is done, it will have a very tight grip. So that diagram says don't tap a cancellous screw. While it's not true for the cortical, there you have to tap it, or you should have an arrangement in the tip of the screw to cut its own threads.
Alok, as a practitioner, that must be the reason many a times you do not tap.
Yes, sir. Sometimes we feel that it gives you a better grip.
Yes, yes. The friction.
Yes, but then the historical question one is going to have, if it was like this, why did Synthes or AO first say that you should have a non-self-tapping screw? They are the ones who started this tap business. Mm. Because at that time, the conception was that you'll get a better grip, and which happens in the cortical screw. If you tap it, it's more efficient, more energy proficient to tap it with a professional tap, because it is made of harder material than the screw is made of, and it's more efficient to cut a thread with the tap. But what has happened over the time when the tap was introduced and today, we have developed a concept called MIPO. We have become more conscious about biology of the bone. We don't want to spend more time exposing it. We want to be short, sweet through a smaller holes. And we also want to do it quickly. So if you do tapping a bone adds to a extra procedure. And if you have to do 7 screws, 7 into say 7 minutes, 1 minute for each thing. Or that's why they said, okay, we'll go back to this non-self-tapping screw. As to a self-tapping screw. Self-tapping screw existed before the AO came in. Everything existed before. AO's smartness is experimentation and marketing. Scientific way, in a good way. Marketing so that we understand and we use. So there is nothing much to fight about. Why did we do this? With self-tapping screw, which are now made more efficiently because of the advanced mechanisms, because of the advanced metallurgy, they have become more efficient than what they were available 40 years ago. In 1977-78, self-tapping screws were available. Zimmer made it.
Yeah. We used to call them Sherman screws, sir.
1975, when I came back from England, I had screws which were self-tapping screws. In fact, most of the screws were self-tapping.
Yes.
They all came and said, no, you should use non-self-tapping. Because I think that time those screws, the self-tapping apparatus was not that efficient. That's why they went for this. And they being perfectionists, they kept on doing that. But now, there's hardly anything to choose. One can do.
Yeah.
But technically, I would say self-tapping screw would be holding faster or stronger than a one which is non-self-tapping screw. I would say that today.
Yeah. And in the 70s and 80s, we used to call them Sherman screws?
Yes.
Sherman screws.
Yes, yeah. Sherman.
So taking this some substance, in a tough cortical young bone, we would tap always, and possibly in a cancellous bone, only near cortex. And in osteoporotic bone, what would be your say? Do we tap or we don't tap?
Cortical bone, normal or osteoporotic? Tapping. Cortical bone.
Yeah.
Normal or osteoporotic. Tapping is required. In cancellous bone, only outer cortex need to be tapped.
Right.
Nothing else.
Right. So, Alok, that question's answer makes it very clear. Next question, yeah.
This question, what happens at the microscopic level when we say the cancellous bone trabeculae are compressed by cancellous screw?
See, cancellous bone is compressible. When a metal thread passes through that, it will mold it. Mold is the word, mold it to its shape. And that's the way, with the molding, you will call it as threading. So, the cancellous bone, as you can see in that femur model that I showed, can be easily compressed by a twister or a corkscrew. When you open your wine bottle, you take a corkscrew and pass it in through there. The corkscrew molds its way. It compresses the cork all around and gets a hold on that. Exactly the same thing happens in cancellous bone. Once I tell you the wine bottle and corkscrew, everybody will understand immediately. Yeah.
Okay, hello.
Anytime you open a wine bottle, use a corkscrew, and as you twist it in, imagine that you are forming the threads inside, which you are actually. And once it goes to far end and take it out, when you take it out, you'll find the threads being there. So that is the way the cancellous screw works in the cancellous bone.
So it is deformation of bone and friction created, both things?
Yes, it is compressed, deformed, compressed, and then because it's a twist, it doesn't come out easily. So whenever the pull-out force is applied, it offers resistance. And that resistance is equivalent to the amount of bone held between each thread with the slide I showed. Because the number of threads are 10, 15, 30, so the strength increases. That's why a fully threaded cancellous screw will have a superior hold than partially threaded cancellous screw. Because number of threads are less, because the number of the small islands of cancellous screw are less or more, and that decides the strength of the screw.
And therefore, in a patient of metafascial region fracture fixation, if you remove cancellous screw after a couple of years, 5 years, 7 years, it becomes difficult to remove these screws. And that must be the reason that the bone...
Yes, the bone is very strongly, is forming there everywhere, and it just holds it back.
Yeah.
In fact, if we are using self-tapping screw and the bone and the tip is protruding from the far cortex, the bone forms in that notch, in that thing, and then it becomes extremely difficult
to take out those
screws. So trick is to try and push it forward a bit and then try to take it out. The first moment, if you push it forward, if you make half a turn in forward direction, it will be much easier to bring it back.
Okay. Alok, we have any more?
Yes, sir. A lot of questions are there.
Yeah, go ahead.
Dr. Ram Prabhu wants to ask, in transverse or short oblique fractures, can we get compression at the fracture site using a simple DCP with divergent screws on both sides?
A simple what?
In transverse or short
oblique fractures. You use a short form, BTC or something. I didn't get that.
Okay, sir, small DCP, simple DCP with divergent screws on both sides.
So,
compression.
What Dr. Ram Prabhu wants to say, if you are using a DCP and if you put two divergence screws on both the ends, is it going to compress more?
Yeah. In short or transverse oblique fractures.
Yes. If you are using a DCP and from both ends you want to compress. Put screws in a dynamic mode.
Yes.
Is that what you want?
Yes,
you can do that from both sides on two occasions. On each side, you can do two screws, but you have to do simultaneously. That's a procedure which goes with the plating part and it's fairly common and fairly ancient. So yes, I didn't bring it up in this one. Okay. Yes, you can do it.
Yes. Next question, Alu.
I need another 10 minutes to complete that talk.
So you would like to go proceed with the lecture right now?
No, I don't mind either way. So maybe we can finish that talk and then go on. And at the end, even if you are running short, I can give my email address and they can ask me questions.
So Alok has prepared a nice question which is engrossed in understanding that question. Alok, we are ready with the next question. I think we can proceed with the talk, sir, now.
So from there we go. The first four things we have done. Now, simple beam screw and the strain reduction. These are the new functions, simple beam screw 2016. For the first time, a new function is applied to a screw fixation. The implant is present as a simple beam with an overhanging head. Now, there is a new method of fixing a transcervical fracture. All this time, we have been using three screws parallelly. Now, Philippa Orlin from Romania, Sofia, Romania, he has devised this method in which three screws are passed in a different way. It's the longest procedure, which we cannot discuss here just now. But one screw, the third one, like here, it is passed as the support beam screw. That's here. It is different. It's in a different plane at an obtuse angle. It is not a leg screw. It does not compress the fracture. It only functions like a support beam, something of an anomaly like analogy like this. It just supports this head gap, but it supports like a trim. It goes something almost vertically like this in these two phases. And as it is said here, it does not compress, it just supports it. Graphically, you can say it has a hole here, something like this. And at the far end also, it is supported. But what it is really doing is taking the load from the top and working like a beam or like a column and giving it a support, like a totem pole is supporting over there. This is a new method of supporting the fracture. And the function mechanically, technically, is not of compression screw, but of a support screw, of a beam, of a column. It is supported three planes, the lateral cortex, inferior cortex, and also the posterior cortex. Lateral cortex, inferior cortex, and the posterior cortex here. Gives strong support to the posterior inferior segment of the head, which is often comminuted. These two places it is supported as a beam, and then again it goes down. It's a screw. It's a different function, different purpose that it has been used. Stronger resistance to varus collapse, easier sliding, prevents cutout, maintains strong fixation. Just to reiterate, both the screws, middle and lower, both they work like this, supporting each other through the axial beams, supporting a different inclination. Arrangement offers a strong support against walking loads, which is constantly changing in physiological conditions. That method is worth discussing even in this forum as a new, and its dynamics and mechanics is entirely new and very, very strong. A major article has appeared in American Academy Journal also about 1.5 years ago. So that's a new method we should all discuss sometime. This picture will give you the analogy that like this tent is supported on these two poles. Similarly, these two screws are exactly doing the same job in different way. So they are all supporting screws, not compressing. But particularly this one does some compression, but this one is entirely supporting screw, no compression. Engineering uses this principle all the time, and all these spots are supporting from this single beam. All these are cantilevered. The beam is supported from here and then supported there and supporting this huge ring and entire roof. So that's the analogy with which it is working like this. Second function is strain reduction screw. This is again not a screw, but a trick, surgical trick. Now, if I showed you this picture, and if I said to you that you may want to do a compression plate or an exchange nail or whatever, but I say that all I'm going to do is put these two screws, then many of us are going to say that did I have a 3 martini lunch that I'm talking this? Just two screws, how can that happen? But exactly that has been the hypothesized and practiced and done there. These two screws in this way, they have been proven. And the insertion is percutaneous. That is even more important to say. This example from the paper that I'm giving you, they have done a nailing. There again, one can say, there should have been two screws, one here and one here, then the screw, this would not happen, this would have been centralized, but anyway, that is not the issue. Then they have put three screws here, and the fracture has gone to complete healing in good time. This paper has been recently published, 2019 in Journal Orthopedic, from Oxford, England. And the screws are either placed as lag or placement screws. It doesn't have to be lag. Just simple screw will serve the purpose. So next time when you see something like this, I'm sure many of you are going to say, just do it. However, know the rules before you screw. And the rules are that the reduction should be satisfactory, acceptable, that there should not be any infection, that the fracture plane and the previous fixation allows for screw placement. All these things are possible, then you can do that. It is called strain reduction screw because what it does is improves the stability at the fracture site. Hypertrophic non-union has occurred because the stability at that point is inadequate. Their hypermobility or inadequate stability. It is not relative stability, it is hypermobility. That's why the fracture has not united. There is lack of stability. On these screws are improving the stability and bringing the relative stability to 2 to 10% level. When that happens, the bone formation will continue. The new theory of bone healing and non-union, BHNN theory by Elliott and others, says that the tissue around the non-union will retain its potential to form new bone, provided there is no infection. If there is infection, everything changes. Otherwise, hypertrophic union always, and non-union, and the atrophic in non-union also many times retains its potential to form the bone. What is lacking is mechanical environment, and that mechanical environment is either too less a movement or too much of a movement. More often, too much of a movement. And if you make mechanical changes like inserting a thicker nail or applying a plate under compression or just inserting just 2 or 3 screws to change the relative stability, make it more stable, bring it down to 2 to 10 level, the bone, the tissue around that area will restart forming bone and will complete the healing. The people who have professed this, Dr. Kothari and others, they do it under general anesthesia and in their setup as a day case. It may not be possible in our case. There they do it as a day case, but under general anesthesia, the insertion of these screws is percutaneous. Fracture site is never looked at. It is percutaneous insertion. The screws may be put as lag or placement screws. They say in their text that even if you are able to engage 2 to 3 threads in the distal cortex, it is more than adequate. If you can get the full hold and produce a good lag, it is wonderful. But even if you can get just a little toe hold on the other side, it still will work. And they are not done any bone marrow or bone graft or bone marrow graft. Neither through RIA, which is available with us, or nor through bone marrow aspiration, which is again available with us on large scale, that is required. All that is required is change the mechanical atmosphere at the hypertrophic site. By introducing these screws, it will change and will go for the healing portion. They do not allow them to walk for 6 weeks, partial toe touching or non-bed bearing, depending on the site and the position. So that will bring to end this today's talk. But I have permission from Dr. Chandak and Dr. Ashok to announce the next webinar, which is on external fixation. The external fixation in late 80s and early 90s was the king. Everybody was expert in external fixator and later on in Elizarov as well. However, the practice has fallen back and external fixation has become rarity. Other day, my friend Dr. Akache said, lot of young doctors have not used external fixation extensively, so it's worthwhile discussing about it. So biomechanical principles of external fixation, both standard monoaxial and also circular, I will deal with on April 21st, which is next Tuesday, same time, same place. And now, if there are questions, I am ready.
Thank you very much, sir, for taking that topic of external fixation. And that would be useful to all these new postgraduates, as well as the permanent students who are the practitioners. So that would be very nice. Alok, we would take up the questions now.
Yes, sir. Sir, there's a question like long oblique fracture is like a parabola. It is difficult to get compression with one screw. So we need to do more than one screws in different directions or same direction? How would you go ahead with this?
In different directions. Say one tends to go at right angles to the fracture line. A spiral fracture line will go at different angles. So it's good to go at different angles.
Okay, sir.
As he showed in one of the cases of humerus, he showed.
Yes. So next question, sir.
Yeah, please go ahead.
So, is it right to put both locking and cortical screw in a single combi hole plate synthesis in a situation where hold of that particular fragment is not long enough?
In the same hole, one wants to put a conventional and this thing?
Yes, sir.
I mean, unless you change the size of the one or the other, size of the conventional screw, this is not possible because the locking will block the conventional hole. Have you tried this? I never even thought of this. So. But it doesn't serve any purpose putting that. If you have passed a conventional screw and it has become loose, best is to take it out and pass a locking screw there. That will do the necessary stabilization. Many times the conventional screw gets loose, you are not happy. So best to take it out, pass a locking screw with the sleeve or the recommended method, and then pass it. In synthesis, you have to use the sleeve all the time. In other methods, you have liberty to do without the sleeve. So follow the system meticulously and put a locking screw.
Yeah. Hello.
Sir, this question was from Patna, Dr. Jaswinder Singh.
Yes.
Now, sir, the next question is from Dr. Jawahar Jethwa, sir. He is asking, is local companies cancellous locking screws with low TPI in shaft and high TPI in head technically correct?
Local companies make cancellous screw with
low TPI as well as high TPI. Yeah. So what he is talking about is the distal femur screws. So there are Indian companies which make cancellous like locking screws.
Yeah.
And the Synthes has 5mm bolt or 5mm screw.
Cancellous locking screw is a fraud.
Right.
No need for a cancellous locking screw. It is actually dangerous because cancellous screws are weaker than the cortical screws. As you see, we've seen here, the locking screw is thicker than standard cortical screw. Here you are locking a screw which is even thinner than the cortical, standard cortical screw. So you are inserting a thinner screw in a locked mode, which is going to withstand more bending loads, higher bending loads. So it is in a risk of breaking at the junction of the shaft and the cancellous thread. So it is dangerous for the surgeons to use a cancellous locking screw. Manufacturers will sell anything.
Yes.
You should be wise enough not to buy it and never to use it, because it is not necessary. It is also dangerous.
So very categorical statement from sir. And most of the companies do make them at a cancellous level for distal femur. Even for the proximal humerus, they make it in a cancellous mode.
Many manufacturers are going to send a supari for me, but that's all.
Go ahead, next question, go ahead.
Sir, Dr. Ram Prabhu, sir, wants to know, locking screws, locking cortical, locking cancellous screws, are they totally different in terms of dimensions, pitch, core diameter, etc.?
Locking cortical screws and locking cancellous screws?
Are they totally different in terms of pitch, core diameter?
We just discussed that, no? That
yes, same question.
Screw is a fraud.
Yeah.
Just don't go there.
Sir, another question, sir. Dr. Ajay Devgar is asking, perfect bone-to-bone contact is necessary for interfragmentary screws. Your comments, sir.
Perfect?
Bone-to-bone contact.
Yes.
Necessary for interfragmentary screws.
Yes.
Your comment.
It is necessary. You must strive for a perfect contact or at least maximum contact. In the dynamic pictures that I showed, the screw hole is eccentric, is not centralized screw for lagging. The proximal proximal cortex will shift sideways.
Right.
You will lose the reduction. So unless there is a contact, how can you lag it? If not 100%, 80-70% contact should be there. There should be good amount that could be pressed hard against each other. What is lagging is pressing hard against each other. So you must have a good contact surface, then only you can lag. It is essential.
So next question, sir. Will the compression still occur if the lag screw does not cross the opposite cortex?
No, it will not, because unless it crosses the upper surface, it will not pull the far fragment towards the near fragment. If it does not pull, then the compression will not again. In fact, it may keep the maintain the fracture line and produce a non-union. So it must come closer, it must go beyond and pull it towards the proximal fragment. Whenever it comes to lag screw, I always use a longer screw than what I measure. For two reasons. If I'm using a self-tapping screw, I want that distal tip a little away. Also, I don't want to miss even a little bit of the far cortex.
Yes.
I want to grab everything, so that gives me a secure feeling. So farther cortex, it must go beyond and pull that cortex towards you.
Yes, sir. Sir, next question, sir.
Yeah, go ahead.
Should the last screw in a locking plate be unicortical, and why?
A large screw.
Last screw in a locking plate. Should be it be unicortical?
Last the terminal screws at the both ends.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Okay. That's a. In again 70s and 80s, the trend was then there was no locking plate, but the plate used to put unicortical screw on the terminal side.
Yes.
The practice became common, but it was withdrawn because it caused more fractures. So unicortical screw, non-locking or locking, strictly no. It should be bicortical. Now, when you want to put terminal screws, they should not be perpendicular, but they should be at angle. When you put the terminal screws at an angle and bicortical, they get better screws, better hold. If your locking system permits you to put the terminal screw in at an angle, certainly go ahead and put it at an angle. But if it doesn't permit, like in Synthes, then put a standard conventional screw at an angle. That is safer and better than putting a screw, locking screw instead action bicortical. In radius ulna, it could produce fractures. At all places, it can produce fractures. So unicortical, no. Also straight, no. At angle, locking or conventional.
Yes, sir. Sir, next question, sir.
Yeah, go ahead.
So what would be the method to reduce and maintain the fragments of an oblique fracture by a lag screw technique?
Oblique fracture by a lag screw technique?
Yes, sir.
It would be safer to reduce that fracture and lag it. If you say, as I explained, lag screw has to be very precise activity. If you just leave it alone without reduction, and then hope that it will come with the traction of the screw or by when it pushes up, you may not get the perfect answer. You may not get the perfect reduction. So as a safe practice, reduce it, and then perfect reduction or compressed reduction may not be necessary, but you must get it approximate reduction. Then you can go for your lag screw technique. And the final pulling or final setting in can be done through the lag screw. That is quite safe.
Alok, for a change, there is a question on my phone as well. So the surgeon from Nagpur wants to know how to use exactly the depth gauge.
Yes,
there are always problem in depth gauge. Yes. So what would be your tips?
Tips and tricks. You want to see
on the side. See, it should get a good hold on the fall. Is again obtuse angle and acute angle is to be described in that. The hook of the depth gauge should get a hold on one cortex. When that happens, suppose this is cortex gets hold here, then you are getting a shorter distance.
Right.
So when you get this kind of hold, add 1 or 2 millimeters extra to that. If you are using it this way, then you will get the adequate distance and you can use the same thing. So it's a bit tricky. Simple thing would be to whatever you get, you increase it by 1 or 2 millimeters. Because mostly it's a tricky situation in lagging, lag screw application. There you don't want to go for a second chance. Use a little longer one, get the perfect pitch on the other side.
Alok, same is your experience? You add up 1 or 2 millimeters usually?
Yeah, I do that. It looks bad. Sometimes people say, why it's jutting out? I say it is my insurance. It is my peace of mind.
Yes. Yeah. So we get answers to many of our routine practices. And this is what usually we would follow.
The peace of mind for surgeon is very good. After doing a plating, if I am not totally happy, I put a small plaster cast for also 2 to 3 weeks. There is no shame in putting a plaster cast if you are not happy. It is ultimately patient's well-being that is in our heart. And if you think you not made it, just put a plaster cast. There are various ways of explaining to the patient. And he doesn't mind another 2 weeks in plaster cast.
Listening to this answer, many surgeons would be feeling safe that they were doing the practice which is in the interest of the patient. Alok, you can go ahead with the next question.
Yes, sir. Next question is, sir. Professor Punkar, sir, from Amravati.
Yeah.
He wants to know how strain reduction screw helps in atrophic non-union, where the biology is failing.
See, so far the convention is in atrophic non-union.
Hello. Sir, am I audible?
Yeah, yeah. We, sir, could listen to your question. No problem.
The atrophic non-union, so far we thought that it is a vascular.
Mm-hmm.
Microscopically, histologically, there is no evidence of vascularity in non-union.
Okay.
The BHN group says that non-union, atrophic non-union also retains potential to form bone like a hypertrophic. Hypertrophic non-union, everybody says it is vascular. The BNH group says the atrophic is also vascular. Only it takes little time. So they still say if there is no infection, everywhere provision is no infection. Once there is infection, every equation, equilibrium changes. So let's not go there. So in non-union, if you are able to pass these things, it is possible. If you produce stability, these screws in that chapter, they have not discussed anything about atrophic non-union. The paper does not have examples of atrophic non-union. It has got only atrophics of hypertrophic non-union. But I'm going by the BHN theory, bone healing non-union theory. They say this could maintain. There's no work from that group about atrophic non-union. But if somebody wants to try out, there is enough evidence to say that it may work. I don't know how you're going to put it through percutaneously and other things.
TBIT is possible, sir.
The other day, that the quality of orthopedic surgeon is that he will change the procedure the very first time he's going to do it. You have just heard about this and now you want to try it in atrophic non-union. That's like a good orthopedic surgeon.
And Alok, this tells about the validity and the usefulness of these lectures.
Yes,
and seeing Dr. Punkar asking and listening to all his lectures, and he had
comments and also a lot of questions also.
Yeah, and senior surgeons like Dr. Jawahar Jethra also, and sir. Dr. From Mumbai also, Ram Professor also asking questions. They're all listening very keenly. So let us take the next question.
Sir, Dr. Pradeep Nimade, next question is an interesting one. Cancellous bone when porotic is brittle. Would screw principle apply here?
Wood principle.
Yeah.
Wood screw principle.
Yeah. In a cancellous bone.
Say wood screw principle being used every day when we insert a cancellous screw. It is a wood screw principle only. In wood screw, when you apply a screw in a furniture, what we do is put a pilot hole and put the screw directly. That is what we do in cancerous area. We have to put a pilot hole and insert this cancerous screw. That's a wood screw principle. The machine screw principle applies to the hard bone, like a metal. Some bones, cortical bone is really hard. And a young person is really, really hard. So you have to use the other principle of making a pilot hole, then making provisions of making a thread in the bone. That you can do either by a tap, a special instrument, or you can use a screw in which the mechanism is already built in, which will cut its own threads and get inserted. So, wood screw principle we are using every day in cancerous.
Alok, similar question is there. So, taking that point, would you recommend driving a cancerous screw by a star drive always, so that it goes like a wood screw with the machine drive?
Wood screw also has got a tapered end. Now, that design we do not use in normal practice. However, that tapered screws we are using in external fixator.
Right.
But there we are using in both cortex and cancellous, and then we call it as radial preload. But that is for next week.
Next week, yeah. We'll wait for that. Alok, you can take the next question.
Sir, this is a comment by Dr. Hemant Patankar, sir. Can one purchase the electronic screwdriver set from the hardware shop for standby screwdriver? for a standby, I mean, in case.
We have been using drills from hardware shop, but to use screws from hardware shop would be dangerous. Because
screwdrivers, he's asking.
Screwdrivers.
Yeah.
Yes.
Screwdriver
set, yes. If they are all metal screwdriver sets, yes, for sure. In fact, Allen keys, the Torx type of Allen keys, I bought from shops in...
Lohar-chan.
I didn't buy Lohar, but I bought somewhere else. But yes, Lohar-chan, we can buy them. Yeah. They are all for industry. As long as we are not using it inside the body, yes, more certainly. We can buy those screwdrivers and use it. But if they come with plastic, then autoclaving is a plan. But those Allen keys or the ones which are all metal, certainly, and autoclave them and use them. No problem.
One tip or one advice I would give is we can ETO them and we smear those screwdrivers or Allen keys with a thin film of oil so that they don't get rusted.
Yeah, that's right. That's important.
Yeah. Alok, go ahead with next question.
The next question is, what is the difference between a carbon and a steel drill bit and which one is better?
Repeat.
The difference between a carbon drill bit, carbon steel, and a stainless steel drill bit.
One more question is added to it.
Carbon steel is very hard. That's why those tips will cut very sharp. But they are very brittle. So if you are a new person at this game, then your hand may wobble and it will break inside. And then you have real trouble. So you can use carbon drills. They're cheaper, but the hard, sharp, etc., etc. But a great risk of breaking it. And that's a very expensive business. Best is to stick it to the things that are available surgically. There's somebody we can go back and say, well, you messed it up. If you go to a hardware shop, buy it and break it inside, then you have to blame yourself saying that you cheapo, you messed it up.
So if you don't break it, you use it correctly. Scientifically, it is okay to use it?
Yes. Yes, so because just a pilot hole. It should be quite, it's okay to use it.
Some amount of metal debris likelihood?
Very, very thin ones for the finger or metacarpal. I have bought drill bits from hardware shop and I have been using it for a long time. Okay. Whenever required.
Nice to listen to that. Yeah. Alok, yes, go ahead.
These questions were from Dr. Ram Prabhu. Another one is from him only. What's the RPM of mechanized drilling and tapping recommended?
Before I answer, please tell Ram that I will take him out for a drink if he stops asking me questions.
And those are really difficult ones which you can't answer on a scientific platform. Alok, the session is getting more interesting as we take up more the questions. No?
Yeah.
So keep up your energy in asking the questions.
I will take Ram out for a drink anyway.
So Alok, go ahead with the next question.
So what is that? Dr. Pradeep Nemare.
I didn't answer Ram's question. What is it?
Yeah.
So the question was, is the RPM of mechanized drilling and tapping recommended? What is the RPM?
700. The drilling speed is usually 700.
So what he is asking is, the drills from the Lohar-chan, if you use for drilling, they work at a very high RPM. So
yes,
is it
they are very high and they are risky. Lohar-chan business is not made for orthopedic surgery. When the orthopedic companies charges heavy fees for the drill, they have put in some hard work in that and they have made some safety arrangements also. So recommended speed is 700, which your any standard company's drill will give you. Yes. Lohar-chan drills are very, very fast and they are troublesome. They tend to spin out of hand also. So if you are using it, nothing happens. Nothing will happen in Ram's hand or Chandak's hand.
But I think the chance of an electric shock would be there in those drills.
Yes, but there is a lesser chance. I mean, those products are also safe for using on masonry and on the furniture. They are just not safe for the orthopedic system. But the trick there is that you get a lead and you hold that lead in your hand and use it as drilling stop and not the main this thing. Use a flexible shaft.
Alok, next question we can take up.
Sir, Dr. Pradeep Nimare's question of wound principle was a bit misunderstood. Like wood screw principle is used everywhere, but the prerequisite is the material should be compressible. In case of porotic bones, the bone is brittle. So would the wood principle hold true here? Since the bone is porotic.
Hey, the ultimate game is at the level of that small fragment between the threads of the screw, that little piece of bone. How strong is that? In porotic bone, that is brittle, that's going to break. So whatever type of screw you are going to use, the fixation is going to be bad. That's why we have switched on to locking screws, where you just use it for just for a support there, but your main strength is outside in the plate or in the external fixator. That's why you are not, you are also not producing any compression or pull out strength at the bone junction.
Yes.
Because that is not your strength. Your strength is coming from outside. In cancellous screw, the strength is coming from pulling the bone, which is not happening. So locking plate will be the answer in porotic bones, locking screws.
But Nemare's problem would be that in a pelvic inside, he won't be able to use a locking plate because of the angles.
Yeah, yeah, but you get free contoured plates everywhere.
Yeah. Okay, that could be possible.
Even for a rib, now there are, for rib fracture, there are locking plates available which can be introduced through MIPO. Instrumentation is available for multiple rib fracture to be treated with MIPO. Special forceps, special hold, special tubes like they use in endoscopic, like the tubular surgery for spine. That has come to rib plates also. Rib fractures can be fixed through MIPO. So it is always possible. Innovation is always there. Whether it reaches in your and my hand, that is the big question.
Yeah. Alok, we will have to rationalize the question. Sir has already put up the slide of his address, email ID. So rationalize all the questions. Yeah, sir, yeah. Good. Yeah, go ahead.
Dr. Jasvinder from Patna, he has a very important question. Is it advisable to remove a deformed screw immediately after putting it, even if the hold is good? Will it affect the trajectory of the new screw? By inserting a screw, the screw is deformed. So should we remove even if it is good?
It is deformed and it is holding.
Yeah.
And leave it there, because when you are trying to take it out, it's likely it may break in your hand there. But if it is deformed and it is loose, then there is no point keeping it there. A loose screw is of no good there. It is going to get, it will be mobile, it will come out, and you take x-ray after 2 months, it's going to bring you bad reputation. And meanwhile, it's not doing any purpose. Thing which is not doing any purpose should not be there. Take it out. I wouldn't dare take out the deformed screw, which is holding very well. I'll say, fine, it's my lucky day. The deformed is still working. Thank you very much. I'll move on.
Yeah.
I'll move.
Yeah. Alok, we can take up the question we have.
Sir, the core diameter of a locking bolt is more than a cortical screws and better strength. This was a comment by Dr. Kunkar, sir, from Amravati.
Yeah, what?
Core diameter of a locking bolt is more than the cortical screws and better strength.
Yes, that is what Thakur sir mentioned in his talk. Yes, yes, we call them as bolt because the feel is something like a bolt, but there is no nut there. He specified, and the core diameter is more, therefore they are more sturdier. So he mentioned that. That finishes the question.
Yeah, yeah, yes.
And that was really very interesting to discuss all these fundamentals. And sir, we are really thankful to you for clearing lot of the doubts, and then also feeling comfortable in certain things which we all commonly do, like having some slab for a couple of weeks, not a harm, and not tapping a cancellous bone, only tapping the proximal cortex. I think, Alok, it would be your turn to just summarize, and then we would end this session. So can you please summarize few important events?
Yeah. So there have been a lot of, like sir, I've covered most of the things fantastically, like from the finer points of anatomy of the screw also, like he was telling about the shapes, holes, compression lags, then the torque, about the hexagonal head, the slotted screw, the Phillips screw. I mean, but the strength of buttress screws, what are the side effects of the buttress screws, then about the new interlocking technology, the threaded, interlocking thread technology. I mean, sir covered most of the topics in sir details, like all the doubts are mostly covered and the remaining questions, they could be solved. The tip, the self-tapping tip, then when to use tap, then to use, irrigate the, with fluid,
yes.
Just before the drilling.
That's a good carry-on.
So I think sir had covered everything in a fantastic way. In just 1 to 1.5 hours, we could get away with locking screw principles.
Yeah.
The conventional screw, the strength of unicortical is only 60%. I mean, everything, sir. I mean,
yes. They were, that was informative, and I would ask all my trolley and sister person in theater to keep a syringe of stream of saline ready before I start drilling. So that's a good take home for me. And thank you, sir. Thank you for elaborating on so many things. They are all useful. I hope all the surgeons, students, and teachers must have enjoyed this talk. Ashok, any pressing question with you remaining, or we have answered most of them?
No, I have forwarded all the questions.
All the questions. Okay.
So you could answer.
Yeah. And I must thank Ashok for providing this wonderful teaching platform, learning platform. It's fantastic, Ashok. If you want to just end up and summarize or say a goodbye, all yours.
I think it was very, very interesting lecture. And again, there are many, very few lectures that we can watch again and again. This is one of those.
Yes.
I think we, many students will watch again and again.
Yes.
And years to come. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
I have my email. If somebody thinks of another question, go send it and I will try and answer it as and when.
Thanks for that offer of sharing your email. And same day, same time, the topic is different. And that would be external fixator. Yeah. The so-called fancied non-union machine we are going to discuss next Tuesday. Thank you very much, Ashok. Thank you, Alok, for wonderful moderation for all those questions and help. Thank you very much. And thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, everybody.
We close the meeting now, Ashok.